pleasure to invite the co-chair of this meeting, Professor Nagler, who will talk about allogeneic stem cell transplantation. So in the myeloma community, allogeneic transplant looks like a taboo sometimes, you know, when we mention this. However, we must acknowledge that when we look to the European activity of allo transplant, actually, it's not only stable, it's always every year slightly increasing, which is very paradoxical because we have more and more drugs, but the allo activity continue to increase moderately every year, which highlight that there is still an unmet need and the colleagues are really referring patients to allo. So, Arnold.
So I would like first to thank Professor Motin, Professor Facon for putting this meeting, superb meeting, and also say that I have not an easy topic, at least in this podium. But I have the luxury that I count the number of slides here, and there was only one slide that mentioned till now allogeneic transplantation by Professor Sonnenfeld yesterday. So we know and we heard in this 2 days meeting that there is a huge improvement in the patient outcome and survival in multiple myeloma, reaching now 10 years. And I will try to convince you that allogeneic stem cell transplantation is the crudest and oldest immunotherapy, because now this is the era of immunotherapy, as you heard just from Philip Moron, monoclonal antibody. So we know that there is a graft versus myeloma effect. We know that there is inverse correlation between chronic GVHD and relapse. We know that after transplant, it could be a platform for immunotherapy, and the oldest one and the crudest one is donor lymphocyte infusion. We know that there is a prospect for long-term disease control, but we also know that the bad name for allogeneic transplant is myeloma is basically because only 7% of the myeloma patients are below the age of 55. And the availability of novel anti-myeloma agents have made allogeneic transplant, I would say, not attractive at all to the most of the clinicians. But there is no doubt, we looked yesterday for a plateau in Raj Kumar talks, and so I put 4 studies that show you there is a plateau with allogeneic transplant in myeloma. So allogeneic transplant can cure myeloma. And this is the first famous paper many years ago by Garton from EBMT at that time, New England Journal of Medicine, 90 patients, long follow-up, more than 6 years, there is plateau. Biology paper in JCO 2006, the C-curves, long-term follow-up, there is a plateau. More recent paper from the Nicholas Kruger with 12 years follow-up, and there is a plateau, especially in patients that achieve CR. And some GMEMA study more recently, thanks to Professor Bruno, that if patients achieve molecular response, there is a plateau. So there is no doubt that allogeneic transplant can cure myeloma. If we now look on the number of allogeneic transplant in Europe, so according to the Chronic Malignancy Working Party, there is about 7,300 allogeneic transplant, but only 12% of them are performed upfront. Only close to 20% of them are performed the auto-allo quite early, and most of them, and this is maybe the problem, 70% perform late, 40% for first relapse, 20% for second relapse, it's still the progression-free survival that they offer is 26%, and overall survival is 33%, and you know that nothing can work when you have more and more and late relapse in multiple myeloma. And similar data are from the States, so about 150 to 200 allogeneic transplant per year, 70% of them are post-auto, and only 15% of them are in early relapse. Now we heard all this meeting about the importance of achieving of minimal residual disease, and these days by next-generation sequencing, multi-parameter cytometry, or the PET-CT, as we heard nicely yesterday from Hervé Aventelousseau, and the PET-CT in imaging. And we all know that if you have better MRD, you are doing better, and the cutoff point, at least with the fax, is 10 to the minus 5. And this is Spanish data that show you that if you reach the 10 minus 5, you have longer time to progression and better overall survival. And we have seen the French data over and over of Michel Attal and Hervé that if you have negative MRD, you have less relapse and you're doing much better. But the crudest way to achieve very deep molecular response in transplant in myeloma, and maybe the oldest and first one, is the transplantation reaching 10 to the minus 6. And this can, as we heard yesterday from the nice talk of Munchi, can be achieved now also with a novel therapy. So why is the bad name of transplant? The bad name of transplant is because this old data of myeloablative conditioning with 30 to 50% transplant-related mortality because the myeloma patients have bone disease, kidney disease, they are elderly, and they are fragile. And then thereafter came the period of the reduced intensity conditioning that were able to drastically cut by half the transplant-related mortality, but the price was higher relapse rate. At the end of the day, the overall survival was the same. So if we look, and this type of reduced intensity transplant paved the way, or were the first one to show that you can intensify the immune therapy of the transplant by donor lymphocyte infusion, as is shown in this paper from Hoven and Germany, with 52 response rate and 70% CR, or in patients with relapsed myeloma with overall response rate of 40 to 67% and CR of 19 to 30%. So we can do the autologous, the tandem, and then the DLI, which looked like old, but the principal are now there with the monoclonal antibody. So if we look on the five big publications with the reduced intensity auto-allo tandem, we can see that roughly the two-year overall survival is about 55%. And the transplant-related mortality at day 100 and 1 year was cut to 5 to 16%, which is quite a big improvement. And then came the era of double auto versus double allo. So the start was very, very impressive and encouraging, which is the MEMA study with Bruno, that showed the advantage of the auto-allo for both progression-free survival and overall survival. Actually, start with Professor Moreau's study that with IFM that showed no even hint of advantage. And then we have the EBMT study with longer follow-up that show advantage in disease-free survival and overall survival, and some hint from the Patema study of better CR with the auto-allo approaches. So these are the New England Bruno study, and these are the EBMT Garton study, and you can see that the curves are separating with longer follow-up. But then came the American study and kill allogeneic transplantation. So this is CTN-0102. This is the design of the study. And this is the curves presented by Krishnan in Lancet Oncology. And there is no hint of advantage of allogeneic transplantation. And this was basically the end of allogeneic transplant. But is this data relevant today? Because the tandem auto-allo studies started in the pre-novel agent induction and maintenance area. And also we have seen all along this meeting how we can improve and how we are doing well with the maintenance of lenalidomide post-transplantation now approved, reaching an overall survival impressive of 10 years, progression-free survival of close to 5 years, and the higher transplant-related mortality is something that we can live. I will show you, we can cut it to 8%, but still it always will be higher than on autologous transplantation. So the tandem auto versus tandem auto-allo data may be of less relevant today because they are not risk-adapted by modern standards, and the post-auto progression-free survival and overall survival have improved dramatically. So is there a subgroup of patients in which we can do allo or should do allo for the high-risk patient? What is high risk? Maybe cytogenetic. And when should we do the allo? And is the immune system that become normal after allogeneic or new after allogeneic transplant is better than the patient immune system? So for the high risk, we have two studies. First of all, the EBMT studies that I just show you that show advantage in what was at that time considered high-risk myeloma 13Q with better overall survival and disease-free survival for auto-allo versus auto-auto. And we have this German study of Enzele that shows that in high-risk myeloma, deletion 13 and deletion 17, there is advantage of the auto-allo. So these are the data from Germany, from Enzele, with median progression-free survival significantly better for the auto-allo versus the auto-auto and for the 17P. And this was translated to base, these are the curves for disease-free survival, progression-free survival, but it didn't translate it to overall survival. But again, the American study was no hint for a better, any effect and any advantage of the auto-allo in high-risk cytogenetic multiple myeloma. So the allogeneic transplant can be a platform for immune manipulation, and this is an old study from Nicholas Kruger, but for the principle that you can give novel therapy, you have to be careful from GVHD when you give Revlimid, as was shown by the Hovon study, and then you can give donor lymphocyte infusion, and nowadays you can do much better. So what about the relapses? We see that the advantage of the auto-allo for relapses is in relapses that occur after 12 months, while earlier relapses, there is no such advantage. We also know that overall survival, if the relapse is by 2 years, is 32% 5-year overall survival, and if it's no relapse by 2 years, the 5-year survival is 80%. And so, of course, if we do the allogeneic for relapse myeloma early, we should be better because there is the myeloma cells are more sensitive to graft versus myeloma effect. There is less clonality involved. There is more sensitive to treatment at subsequent relapse, and they're more likely to be in CR at transplant. But interestingly for me, these 3 periods, there is no change, but this is only 2013, no change in early relapses in this 3 period. And of course, if you wait with the transplant and do the transplant for late relapse, so it's a relapse at 5 years, you can see no advantage for allogeneic transplant, while with 1 year early relapses, you have advantage on allogeneic transplant, and this is not different to any other mode of therapy in multiple myeloma. So now in transplant, we are in the era of post-transplant cyclo, non-T-depleted haplo, and this is a slide that was given me by Hari Parmaswaran that has this talk in New Delhi. So he has, from a medical college, Wisconsin. So he had 41 patients. You can see that they are quite advanced. You can see here the Soro score. You can see some of the patients with plasma cell leukemia. This is a time from diagnosis. And he performed the post-transplant cyclo, and you can see very impressively, you remember we start with 53% transplant-related mortality. Now the transplant-related mortality and 100 day and 2 years are 8%, but the problem is a very high relapse rate at 2 years, 89%. So the 2-year progression overall survival is 48%, and again, unbelievable low transplant-related mortality for advanced myeloma patient. And we can, and we will do better, because we have now, as we heard all over the meeting, and Professor Philip Morora just now, the monoclonal antibody, we have the NKDLI, we have the IMIDs, we have the PD-1 blockade, we can choose the donor with skill mismatch, and we can try to design conditioning that is more suitable and effective for myeloma. So for sure we will do better in relapse, and now that we have the platform with low transplant-related mortality, maybe we can get into the play. So you can envision that in patients with low-risk myeloma, of course, the transplant-related mortality is high, and then the price is too high, and you are not going for allogeneic transplant. But in patients with high-risk myeloma, at anyway is do 17p or 11-14, that anyway doing very bad, maybe it's worthwhile to pay the price of the transplant-related mortality, which hopefully will be less than 10%. And then transplant is always the crude way for allogeneic transplantation. And in the afternoon, we will start to hear about cellular therapy in myeloma. So this is kindly by San Miguel from the review he wrote. We know that our CAR-TC will be presented by Professor Enceles. This is the New England Journal paper with the first patient with debatable if he respond to melphalan or to CAR-19 cell, but he's the first patient. The paper in New England with 12 patients, some of them respond nicely for the card, the first card. And now we have even a better card, like Professor Enceles, which soon tell us a B-cell maturation antigen. And the 6 patients that were treated and published last year in Blood, with some of them even stringed CR. So we have what to do either with transplant or without transplant. And there are several other target antigens that people are doing studies now with CAR T-cells. We also have the tumor vaccination. David Avigan is not here, but he has a nice program at Harvard, and now multi-center study in the state with the CTN about vaccination and myeloma. And we heard about anti-PD-1 that are not so effective as single drug, or only with immunotherapy, only with a novel agent, but maybe after transplant has another role, but because the expression of the PD-1 is increased when you have MRD positive or advanced disease, as was shown again from Spain. So if to summarize from the consensus paper published in 2015 and still true today in Blood Biology by Sergio Girald, so patient allogeneic stem cell transplantation should be considered appropriate therapy for any eligible patient at early relapse, so less than 24 months from relapse, after primary therapies that include autologous transplantation and or high-risk factor, which is cytogenetic and LDH. Allogeneic transplant should be performed in the context of clinical trial. This is done. The role of post-transplant maintenance is done and approved, and prospective randomized studies are needed. And the same conclusion are published in Leukemia 2016 by the International Myeloma Working Group. So allogeneic transplant can cure myeloma. Transplant-related mortality have been drastically reduced. Transplant can achieve negative MRD at the 10 to the minus 6. This is type novel drug therapy. Some of the studies should be now repeated with the area of novel drug therapy and maybe with post-transplant cyclo. All the new development of myeloma that we are excited for the last 2 days can be given pre- and post-transplant, and cellular therapy was born in transplant unit. And last but not least, to thank Professor San Miguel, Nicholas Kruger, Professor Moti, Hari Parmaswaran, and Hilam again that helped me for data and slide for this presentation, and my own myeloma team, Merav Leibel, head of the service, Adrian Dueck, and Katya Bider, that are in the audience. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Arnon, for this elegant historical overview and future perspective about allo.